Learn about new Azure SQL binding capabilities for Azure Functions this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Drew, a program manager on the Azure Data team. Drew, thanks so much for joining us today.
Hey, Anna, thanks for having me. I'm super excited to be here, start off this new year talking about Azure Functions and Azure SQL.
Yeah, always a pleasure to have you on. You've talked about a lot of interesting topics on our show. But today, like you said, we're going to be talking about Azure Functions and bindings for Azure SQL. And I just have to start us off at the beginning and ask, like, what are Azure Functions? What are Azure SQL bindings? And how do they work together?
Yeah. So Azure Functions is a serverless platform that allows developers to bring code to Azure and run that. So they don't have to worry about managing the infrastructure. We know and love Azure SQL as this kind of world-class database that has all these scalability options as well as a serverless tier. So when you put that together with something like Azure Functions, you have a lot of really exciting possibilities. However, when you're developing and working with databases, a lot of times you'll have to find a driver or a library to work with to connect your code to a database. And that's where the power of these Azure SQL bindings for Azure Functions come in. It simplifies out a lot of that code to allow you to focus on the innards of your Azure function.
Cool. Yeah. I mean, at first understanding, it makes sense. I'm always down to hear things getting more simple and easier for me to get to work. So how do these Azure SQL bindings actually work?
The Azure SQL bindings takes a connection string and a little bit of information around the query that you want to run against your database, whether it's selecting data into the function or taking data out of the function and putting it into the database. Those two pieces of information, that configuration, is all you need to work with that binding and then connect your Azure SQL database to a function.
Awesome. Cool. Seems. Yeah, go ahead.
I do have a demo that we can walk through.
That'll
take a look at those two different input and output bindings. So the example that I brought in today to kind of bring some of this to light is a quick web API. Now, you can use functions for different scenarios, but kind of one of the most foundational ones is working with web APIs. And I just want to write an API that gets items, rows out of a database. When I put together that input binding, this snippet of code, that's your database configuration for the function. This is it. So you're worrying about the query, you're telling it, hey, I just want to give it a text command, and then this is where my connection string setting is. This is the custom code, and within VS Code, there are tools to help put this together. So we can pop over into VS Code, where I have an Azure function project and a function that uses this input binding. So we have a function that runs when it gets a web request and the input binding that takes data from the database and inputs it to the function. So that's why it's called an input binding, is it inputs into the function. Mm-hmm. It runs this query against an item table, and then it's going to return those items back. So when I run a get request, I get it back. We can do more things with this. We can find out how many items were there. We can work with it within the function. So if you have more business logic, have at it. But if you want to run a query against a database, you can do so. The table is empty at the moment, so it's not going to be super exciting when I run this get request. It's empty. That's okay. I mentioned input and output bindings. So the output bindings allow us to add new items. We're going to output data from the function into the database. And fortunately, those bindings are just as easy to use as the input bindings. You tell it the table where it needs to go and the connection string that it's going to use. And in that case, I have another HTTP trigger. So this is another API that we send a post request to. That's what causes the function to run. And then I actually have two output bindings on this. The first one is going to that item table. And then the second one, because you can do more than one binding on a function, is going to be logging some information about the request, just saying, hey, I've made a request. Now, you can take in data from either the body of a request or the query string. You can connect this to other options. But at the end of the day, what we want to see is, let's get some data into that item table. So let's try out this function. I'm just going to add something about pears being an oblong fruit. And when I send that request, it says 200 OK. Let's see our database. Do we have pears? Yes, we have pears. So we've added data to the database.
We nice. That seems like a good, just a good example of showing both sides. Like, you showed how we can go use the input bindings as well as the output bindings.
Yeah. It's super exciting because now when I run that GET request, we see pairs. Oh,
there you go. So full circle.
Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. Hey, a couple questions. I noticed that you showed us this in C Sharp. Are there plans, or does this exist for other languages?
Yeah, so functions are available broadly for Python, JavaScript, Java, PowerShell. There's a bunch of languages supported by Azure Functions, and these bindings are being ported over to other languages as well. So with the addition of C Sharp right now out of the gate, like we saw today, we're working on Python and JavaScript up next, and just going to kind of go down the path. We're committed to bringing this across all of the languages that are first-class citizens on functions.
Gotcha. That's awesome. And you mentioned that these were Azure SQL bindings. Does that, you know, what does that include as far as Azure SQL goes? And does it also include SQL Server?
Yeah. So the name Azure SQL is used broadly in this sense. When you configure the binding, you're giving it a connection string. And that is, I'm going to say, the limitation. Your Azure SQL database managed instance, SQL Server on an Azure VM, SQL Server anywhere with connectivity to your Azure function can use this. So I'm going to pop into my app settings where this connection string is stored. In this case, it's connecting to a developer instance on my local machine. So as long as you can get this connection string with connectivity to an Azure function, you're good to go.
That's pretty cool. That's awesome. I see a lot of use cases for this. And I myself, who worked with functions in Azure SQL, I'm going to see the benefits of how this really simplifies that process. For you know, DBAs or data professionals who maybe haven't worked with Azure Functions as much, are there particular scenarios you see folks using Azure SQL, especially these new bindings and Azure Functions together?
Yeah. So as a developer, I get super excited about Azure Functions because you can connect them to so many things. But that excitement is not limited just to developers. Data analysts and DBAs both have a lot of potential capabilities with these functions, because when you run an input binding, and we've got system.data.commandTypeText here, this can also be a stored procedure. So let's say you have a stored procedure that cleans up some data and you want to run a function on a schedule. You can do that, and you're setting up data cleaning, or you're running a stored procedure that manages some database or server maintenance. There's a lot of different options of basically interdatabase connectivity or connecting into data pipelines and really doing more rich object manipulation along the way.
Definitely. Yeah, I see a lot of options here, especially since, for example, like you can run Azure Functions on a timer trigger type of thing. So maybe that would relate to any scheduling you might be doing in another way on-prem or somewhere else.
Yeah, for sure.
Awesome. So as folks get started with this, do you have any tips and tricks or advice for people who are just getting started with Azure Functions and these new Azure SQL bindings?
Yeah. So I always recommend that people start with like pick one example that you want to take a look at. And so the example that we walked through today is kind of a introductory input and output binding, but we did build out a bigger example for a to-do backend app. And that link will be in the description for the video. And that allows you to add items to a to-do list, remove items from a to-do list, get all of them. There's a lot of different interconnectivity. And so kind of dreaming up what you can work on and either going from an example or kind of starting small is certainly a recommendation. The SQL Server extension for VS Code has an additional command to help you configure the input and output bindings. So if you get lost in the docs, hop into the tool and say add SQL binding and see if it can help you put it together.
Cool. That's awesome, Drew. Thanks so much for coming on the show today. I learned a lot about Azure SQL bindings and some of the benefits, and I think our viewers probably did as well. To our viewers, if you like this video, go ahead and give it a like. Leave us a comment and let us know what you think of Azure SQL bindings, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.